thank you for this opportunity to be with you to discuss Black Lives Matters and our collective humanity. Michael Sandel is a professor of government at Harvard University, and he teaches a course on justice, where in the beginning of the course, he poses the question, what is the right thing to do? He invokes Aristotle's concept of morality to examine the missing element in democratic debate. He asks the students the same question that Aristotle asked them 2,300 years ago. Suppose we're giving out flutes, he says. Who deserves the best ones? The students answer with three options: the best player, the worst player, and or the random citizen. Aristotle sides with the best player because he says that flutes are meant to be played well. That's their purpose. Sandel argues that when making such a decision, we have to consider the purpose of a thing as well as the qualities in it worth honoring. Sandel says, and I quote, "There is a tendency to think that if we engage too directly with moral questions, that we create a recipe for disagreement, and for that matter, a recipe for intolerance or coercion." Sandel concludes that it seems to me a far better way to have mutual respect is to engage deeply with the moral convictions that citizens bring to public life, rather than having them leave their deepest moral convictions outside before entering. We gather today in a brave space, all because of this thing called race. What is happening predominantly in America and is now ever visible, this proliferation of Black and brown bodies being murdered predominantly by white men, this Black Lives Matters movement has taken the world by storm. There is a global civil unrest, all because of this thing called race. A people who created a hashtag in a moment of anger and fear has now become a movement, all because of this thing called race. The concept of race was created as a classification of human beings with the purpose of giving power and legitimacy to white people over non-white people. Race is a political construct created then by people that is not a natural development. The entire construct of race then is a false classification and is not based on any real or accurate biological or scientific truth. Whereas race is a false construct, I argue, ethnicity isn't. Ethnicity is solid. It is a connector to particular groups of people that share common senses of ancestry, traditions, languages, and dialect. I am of the opinion, and I believe, that I have evidence that we can deconstruct race over the next four generations. However, it will take courage and conviction of our collective humanity to bring about dismantling of centuries of theories that have divided us. Starting with the term white, it has to be dismantled. This classification that came about in the 1700s in the British colonies of North America, Europeans immigrating into the New World for many reasons, seeking prosperity while many people were escaping persecution, particularly religious and ethnic conflicts. As Europeans arrived in America, such groups as Germans and Dutch and English and French were brought into close proximity, most for the first time. The category of white was created as a political construct, used as an organizing tool to unite Europeans in order to consolidate strength, increase their ability to maintain control and dominate over the Native Americans and African slaves, which in many places outnumbered Europeans. In Paul Kibble's work, Uprooting Racism, How White People Can Work for Racial Injustice, he asserts, whiteness is constantly shifting boundaries, separating those who are entitled to certain privileges from those who are vulnerable to violence in justification of their not being white. There are four key factors that have constructed race and therefore creating this racial divide: religion, social science, medicine, and eugenics. During the Reformation in the 16th and 17th centuries, a key question among Christian religious hierarchy was whether Blacks and Indians had souls, whether or not they were human. In this time period, Europeans were exposed more frequently to Africans and to indigenous people of North and South America. And the church vacillated between opinions. The Catholic and the Protestant churches arrived at different answers to the questions at different times, which created a significant difference between two systems of slavery. With the increasing importance of slavery, religion was used as a means to justify racist division, classifying people of color as pagans and soulless. However, as a substantial number of people of color converted to Christianity, and as the religion itself lost much of its power, it had to legitimize something, the brutality of slavery, and that was all necessitated through a racist system. In the early 1800s, ethnographic and anthropologist societies were being established. Many of those conversations in those societies were focusing on race, the mixing, the mix of race, as Africa and Asia and Australia and the South Pacific were rapidly being colonized. The native people around the world were disappearing. In the 19th century, Darwin published On the Origins of the Species in 1859. Documenting the process of evolution, Darwin believed that the weak die off and the strong survive. Although evolution's theory is not racist, philosophers and social scientists used Darwin's theories in this scientific effort as a way to justify genocide and racism. In 1864, W. Winwood Reade, an esteemed member of London's Geographic and Anthropological Society, published a book called Savage Africa. He ended the book with a prediction on the future of the Black race. He said, and I quote, "England and France will rule Africa. Africans will dig the ditches and water in the deserts. It will be hard work, and Africans will probably become extinct. We must learn to look at the result with composure. It illustrates the beneficiary law of nature that the weak must be devoured by the strong." These and other motivations of scientific research turned into this ideal of extermination. Through the 16th, 17th, and 18th century, people used different terms to explain racial differences. Classifications over the years became three major theories. Two were based upon linguistics, mongoloid and caucasoid, which referenced geographic reasons. However, the last word, negroid, referred to color. None of these terms are based on genetic differences, but rather upon European and European American stereotypes of cultural differences and mismeasures of physiological characteristics. In 1866, the Church of England's Frederick Farr lectured on the aptitude of race, which he divided into three groups: savages, all Africans, indigenous people, people of color, with the exception of Chinese; the semi-civilized, Chinese who once were civilized, but now their society had been arrested in development; and then ultimately the civilized, the European and the Semitic people. In 1850, Robert Knox authored The Race of Man, a Fragment. He took a particular prejudice and formed within his concepts the scientific conviction that race and intelligence are linked to culture and hierarchy. He concluded that people of color were intelligently inferior, not because of the brain size, but rather their brain texture and the lack of nerve endings. Later, we found out that his work was only based on an autopsy of one colored man. However, Knox's studies and others like him were the basis of the 20th century eugenics, Of course, eugenics is an effort to breed better human beings by encouraging the reproduction of people with good genes and discouraging the bad. The United States, of course, took eugenics and ran with it, making it mainstream in society. And by 1928, 376 separate college courses were being taught all throughout the United States on eugenics. Between the 19th and 20th century, over 600 separate pieces of anti-Asian legislation were passed, limiting Asians from citizenship. Non-citizens had almost no rights. Whites could kill Asians with imputing upon them because they could not testify in court. Eugenics provided a set of arguments to support existing restrictions on interracial marriage. In 1915, in the United States, 28 states had banned marriage between a white person and a person of color. The Virginia Racial Integrity Act of 1924 is prominent amongst the laws. Because of it, we understand that within 10 years, the same laws were found in Nazi Germany as it related to people of Jewish blood. The Virginia Racial Integrity Act was not successfully challenged and struck down until 1967. It took the state of Alabama in the United States until November of 2000 to strike down the law. This thing here, skin, it has defined race, and it is a horrible disease that I believe has a cure. The skin has these multiple levels, and it seems as though the outer level, the epidermis, is the level upon which has become the defining agent, all because of this thing called race. We've spent generations living with a false narrative of race because of an outer layer that has now been given to breeding generations of hate, venom, bigotry, racism, and death because of an outer layer of skin. That is why the late Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said that he dreamed of a day where one would be not judged by the color of their skin, but the content of their character. Within our character is where we find our soul. Greek philosophers such as Socrates and Plato and Aristotle understood that the soul must have a logical faculty, the exercise of which the most divine human action exists. At the defense trial of Socrates, he summarized his teachings as nothing other than an exhortation for his fellow Athenians to excel in the matters of the psyche, since all bodily good are depending upon such excellence. In Judaism and Christianity, only human beings have immortal souls, although immortality is disputed with in Judaism, and the concept of mortality perhaps has been deeply influenced by Plato. In the biblical literature, it says that this creator breathed into dust, and dust became a living soul. Rather than exploring the color of our sin, I'd rather we become brave and consider the color of our souls. To look into the interior rather than the exterior to identify our collective humanity. With the murder of Black and brown bodies, it necessitates the declaring that Black lives matters. But I believe it is time to identify something much deeper than race: our morality, our quest to understand, whether defined by religion or philosophy or mythological traditions. I think it is time to dig deep into the ethereal essence of our being. I by no means offer a pass to the perpetrators of such terrorism. I believe that we must interrogate and investigate. We must analyze race, culture, systematic white privilege, power, and fragility, and then take that knowledge and build on it towards our collective humanity, so that no one is deemed subhuman or without a soul. It will take generations, and I understand the urgency of now, but we cannot fool ourselves that we can dismantle systematic racism in a day or a week, or with a protest, or toppling down a statue and rolling it down the middle of the street into the harbor, or having a few family members and friends who are the others believing that we are different in some way, so our souls have been redeemed. Nor can we believe that it can be done simply by laws alone. We look to the American Civil Rights Movement as a model, and yet we miss the most important element of the movement. The movement was created because there was an uncivil group of people that needed laws to make them civil, because they believed that other people did not have a soul. People argue and fight when they see the hashtag All Lives Matter. Well, all human beings do matter. And if we as a collective look more deeply into who we are, I believe we have the answers. Through the halls of the University of Pennsylvania and Georgetown and Harvard, when I completed at those institutions and I got my degrees, embedded on them was Veritas. In Roman mythology, Veritas means truth. The goddess of truth, the daughter of Saturn, called Coronis in the Greek. It is believed that institutions of higher education where we research, teach, and learn are places that we discern the truth and are prepared to face the world to become change agents. Institutions of higher education where academics and students alike sit in the halls are the place where we activate within our disciplines to disrupt the normative. Because together we are on the quest for truth. And that truth is what we have to embrace to change the world. As Newcastle, as we grapple with this moment, we embrace truth. And I believe as we embrace truth, we will find the necessary elements to change and to be a leading institution to go from Newcastle to the world. Thank you.